Welcome to worship at Lutheran Church of the Incarnation on this 13th Sunday after Pentecost. You can visit our website at lcidavis.org and download the bulletin where you can follow along with the service if you would like. Also there you will find our Give tab. We ask that you give whatever you're able to help support the ongoing ministries here at LCI. Here you will also find a download for the children's activity that you may download for any young ones or any that are just young at heart. Today we continue to ask for prayers for Pastor Dan Smith as he is at home recovering from brain surgery. And at the same time, we'd also like to thank Pastor Vern Holmes for being with us today to share with us the gospel and his message. In today's worship service, we will hear two difficult yet very important messages. The first one, to love everybody, even those that are hard to love. The second message, we will listen to Jesus sharing his fate with his disciples of death on the cross and resurrection. To this, Peter begs him to stop this from happening. And Jesus reminds Peter, his disciples, and the rest of us that their and your calling of discipleship is not an easy calling, and that they and us too must be willing to lay our lives down for what we believe in. Please join us in the Confession and Forgiveness, previously recorded by Pastor Dan.
Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, who forgives all our sin, whose mercy endures forever. Amen. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hid, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Most merciful God,
we confess
that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Holy Trinity, Creator, Redeemer, and Sanctifier. Amen.
Savior spake, all in my way abiding. Deny yourselves, the world forsake. Obey my call and guiding. Oh, hear the cross, whatever betide. Take my example for your guide. I am the light, I light the way, a godly life displaying. I bid you walk as in the day, I keep your feet from straying. I am the way, and well I show how you must sojourn here below. I teach you how to shun and flee what haunts your soul's salvation, your heart from every guile to free, from sin and its temptation. I am the refuge of the soul, and lead you to your heavenly home. Then let us follow Christ our Lord, and take the cross appointed, and firmly clinging to his word, in sufferings be undaunted. For those who hear the battle strain, the crown of heavenly life obtain.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all, and also with you. Let us pray. O God, we thank you for your Son, who chose the path of suffering for the sake of the world. Humble us by his example, point us to the path of obedience, and give us strength to follow your commands. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Our reading today comes from Romans 12, 9 through 21. Let love be genuine. Hate what is evil. Hold fast to what is good. Love one another with mutual affection. Outdo one another in showing honor. Do not lag in zeal. Be ardent in spirit. Serve the Lord. Rejoice in hope. Be patient in suffering. Persevere in prayer. Contribute to the needs of the saints. Extend hospitality to strangers. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse them. Rejoice with those who rejoice, and weep with those who weep. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be haughty, but associate with the lowly. Do not claim to be wiser than you are. Do not repay anyone evil for evil, but take thought for what is noble in the sight of all. If it is possible, so far as it depends on you, live peaceably with all. Beloved, never avenge yourselves, but leave room for the wrath of God, for it is written, "Vengeance is mine, I will repay," says the Lord. Now, if your enemies are hungry, feed them. If they are thirsty, give them something to drink, for by doing this, you will heap burning coals on their heads. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. The word of God, the word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. From that time on, after Peter confessed that Jesus was the Messiah, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and undergo great suffering, and that at the hands of the elders and the chief priests and scribes, and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "God forbid it, Lord, this must never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a stumbling block to me, for you are setting your mind not on divine things, but on human things." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone wants to become my followers, let them deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For those who want to save their life will lose it, and those who lose their life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit them if they gain the whole world and forfeit their life? Or what will they give in return for their life? For the Son of Man is to come with his angels in the glory of the Father, and then he will repay everyone for what has been done. For truly I tell you, there are some standing here who will not taste death before they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." The Gospel of our Lord.
Good morning. So today with me, I brought some medals. Now, these are my daughter's swimming medals, but they're pretty cool, right? And they've got the red, white, and blue. Where else do you think you might see some medals like this? Well, I was actually thinking the Olympics. And you know what? I'm really sad this year because we were supposed to have the Summer Olympics, and it got postponed until next summer. But the Summer Olympics are my favorite. I love everything about them. I love the gymnastics. I love the track and field. I love the water polo. I love soccer. But I think my most favorite is the swimming and diving competitions. And mostly that's because that's what I participated in when I was younger. Now, I want you to think about a certain young swimmer. He's not as young anymore, but he's still very famous. His name is Michael Phelps. And if you haven't heard of him before, ask your parents about him because your parents guaranteed have heard about him before. But he is the most decorated Olympian and he has a tremendous amount of medals in all different sorts of swimming competitions. And I'm going to tell you a little story about Michael Phelps that I think you might like. So one day when Michael was about 11 years old, he was swimming in a pool in Baltimore, Maryland, way on the other side of the United States. And a swim coach by the name of Bob Bowman noticed him. And he immediately recognized Michael's potential. He knew that he was a very special boy and that he had the makings of an Olympian. So he went to talk to Michael's parents and he said, "You have a very gifted boy and I would like to coach him. But I want you and Michael to understand that he's gonna have to give up a lot of things if he wants to train with me and become the swimmer I think he can be. He has a lot of potential." So at 11 years old, Michael gave up a lot of things that you enjoy as a kid. He didn't go to regular school. He didn't have a lot of play dates with his friends. He didn't really have any sleepovers. He basically ate, slept, and swam. Now he gave up his normal life because he knew that he had something greater to fulfill. And just as Coach Bowman saw this hidden potential in Michael Phelps, Jesus sees this potential in every one of you. Now we know about Jesus's chosen 12 disciples and we've heard the stories about them in the Bible, but you are also a disciple of Jesus. And in the story, Jesus is sharing with his disciples that someday soon he will die on the cross and he will rise again in 3 days. And Peter, one of his disciples, was really, really, really upset. He was kind of scared and he said, "Jesus, you have so much power. You can put a stop to this." And Jesus got frustrated with Peter and a little angry. And he said, "You know, Peter, I can't do that. I'm not willing to do that. I came to this world for one thing. And that's to lay down my life for something that I feel is a good cause. And if you want to be my disciple, Peter, and the rest of your disciples, you have to be willing to do the same thing." And so Jesus asks us to do that. And it's not always easy to tell your friends about Jesus. It's not always easy to be a disciple. But in the long run, it's worth it. It's worth it to give up a little bit of normalcy so that you can be a disciple of Jesus and fight for what you believe in. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for sending Jesus and we want to be like him as much as possible. We know that we can never really realize our full potential, but we ask that you help and you guide us through this journey. In your name we pray, amen.
Just a small message before we begin the sermon this morning. We have been watching the devastating news regarding the devastating fires throughout California and the aftermath of Hurricane Laura in the southeast. You can help those in need by going to elca.org and making a gift to Lutheran Disaster Response. That's elca.org and Lutheran Disaster Response. Grace and peace be yours from God our Sovereign and from our Lord and Savior, Jesus the Christ, and from the life-giving power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Today's gospel lesson and epistle are well matched. In the gospel, Jesus tells the disciples that if they would be followers of his, that they would need to deny themselves and take up their cross and follow him. Paul's letter may be a little bit more compatible. It's a list of the how-tos, the do's and don'ts of denying self and carrying a cross. Jesus' words can be very unsettling for us. Our culture is not big on self-denial or on cross-bearing. And Paul's advice in the letter to the Romans might be a little easier, but it's still countercultural. His advice for the disciplined practice of living out the transformed life includes such things as not lagging in zeal, or in other words, don't get tired of doing good, and not repaying anyone evil for evil. Do not respond in kind. But Paul offers a positive list of actions that we should take, things such as hold fast to what is good, love one another, rejoice in hope, and during these trying times to be patient in suffering, and contribute to the needs of the saints. We live in troubled times, and the need for a positive voice for transforming and renewing our society is great. The shooting of another unarmed Black American and the ensuing response of peaceful protests on the one hand and rage and violence on the other underscore the need for our transformation. The two different responses to the shooting of Jacob Blake point to the truth of Jesus' words about seeking to save one's life and losing it, or losing one's life and finding it. If we seek to save our lives but to preserve our white privilege, we will indeed end up losing all as we spiral downward into hatred, divisiveness, and chaos. But if we lose our lives, that is, denying white privilege and seek reconciliation, we will gain the abundant life that Jesus came to reveal. But it doesn't just happen like magic. It comes with costly discipleship. John Lewis, the late U.S. representative for Georgia's 5th Congressional District, wrote an essay shortly before his death. In that essay, he urged citizens to get into good trouble in fighting for the soul of America. Lewis reminded us, recalling words from Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., that we are all complicit when we tolerate injustice, that it's not enough to say that it will get better by and by. Each of us has a moral obligation to stand up, and to speak out, that when we see something is not right, you must do something. In other words, silence is not an option. In Romans 12, we have Paul's instruction for getting into good trouble. Following the way of Jesus, talked about denying self and picking up our cross, is to resist evil and injustice in the world, but to do so in a non-violent manner. The point is that the transformation of our world, the gaining of our life, is found not in responding to evil with more evil, but in being willing to put our own lives on the line, speaking truth to power, and standing up for the sake of the world that God so loved. To respond to evil with evil only brings about more evil. To respond to violence with more violence only causes more violence. To see this truth, one only has to look at the pattern of violence and chaos from unruly protesters in reaction to police violence. It only brings about more violence, whereas peaceful protests brings about the potential for change. But to do nothing at all supports the status quo and contributes or continues the injustice, showing the truth of Jesus' words that those who seek their life to save their life will lose it. To do nothing is to invite the status quo to continue unchecked and unchallenged. But by getting into good trouble, while it may be costly in the short term, ultimately will bring about new life. Thus, those who lose their life for the sake of the reign of God will find it. But that is not pie in the sky and the sweet by and by. Rather, it is entrusting the promises of God in the hope that the abundant life that Jesus came to reveal is indeed possible on earth as it is in heaven. So John Lewis, long ago, with others on March 7, 1965, led the protest march across the Edmund Pettus Bridge in Selma into a waiting phalanx of state troopers in riot gear. Ordered to disperse, the protesters silently stood their ground, and the troopers responded with tear gas and bullwhips and rubber tubing wrapped in barbed wire. In the melee which came to be known as Bloody Sunday, a trooper cracked Mr. Lewis's skull with a billy club, knocking him to the ground, then hit him again repeatedly as he tried to get up. Costly grace indeed. However, televised images of the beatings of Mr. Lewis and others outraged the nation and galvanized support for the Voting Rights Act, which President Johnson presented to a joint session of Congress 8 days later and signed into law on August 6th. Those who lose their life for the sake of the gospel will find it, but it is costly grace indeed. But as Lewis reminds us in his essay, democracy is not a state, it is an act, and each generation must do its part to help build the beloved community. Each generation, when you see something wrong, you must do something. A more recent example of costly grace can be found in the life of Colin Kaepernick, who, in order to protest police brutality and the pattern of killing of unarmed black men, began to kneel during the singing of the national anthem at the beginning of football games. That nonviolent action of protest resulted in his being shut out of the NFL and losing millions of dollars in his life endeavor. Costly grace indeed. But Kaepernick's action have indeed helped to shed light on the continuing problems. With the killing of George Floyd, public awareness has galvanized around this issue. It has also resulted in other black athletes adding their voices to the issue, with the NBA Bucks refusing to play this past week in response to the police shooting of Jacob Blake. That action has sparked a continuing protest among other major league sports athletics. And this week, we saw MLK's granddaughters brought a powerful voice to the current March on Washington, keeping alive her grandfather's dream. History repeating itself is a reminder that democracy is an act, and each generation must do its part. But in the face of change, the powers that be will react with increased violence and will continue to do whatever they can to maintain their power. So what can we do in response? In the light of white supremacy and white privilege, in the light of racial discrimination codified as law and order, how do we lose our lives for the sake of the gospel? Last year, the ELCA Council adopted the following resolution. As church, we are called to confess the sin of racism, condemn the ideology of white supremacy, and strive for racial justice and peace. Beyond statements and prayers, we are called to also act and to respond to injustice. We invite you to commit to one or more of the following actions. Sign the pledge. I commit to study, prayer, and action to become an anti-racist individual in an anti-racist church. Work to dismantle racial injustice. Learn the history of systemic racism in this country and the ways racism and white supremacy impact every aspect of our life together. Oh, what an exciting time that we live in. God is calling and our church is responding. Our world is turning. I encourage you to continue to explore the move from being conformed to the world to being transformed by the power of God at work within you. LCI's social justice group currently is sponsoring a dialogue on Austin Channing Brown's book, I'm Still Here. On Wednesday evening, September 2nd, there will be a Zoom gathering to continue that conversation. In preparation for that gathering, you are encouraged to watch the video, An Evening with Austin Channing Brown. The digital address for that video and for the Zoom meeting on Wednesday are listed in the Wednesday update and in today's bulletin. Now, you may be uncomfortable with this process. I am. But do not despair. So was the Apostle Paul uncomfortable. So was Peter and the rest of the disciples. And so is every person who has dared to allow the Holy Spirit to enter in and begin the process of transforming their minds. Just remember that you are not alone. God is at work among us. As John Lewis neared his death, he concluded his essay with these words. When historians pick up their pens to write the story of the 21st century, let them say that it was your generation who laid down the heavy burden of hate, and at last that peace finally triumphed over violence, aggression, and war. So let us together heed the call of the gospel to deny ourselves and to pick up our cross and follow Jesus. And let us take to heart the instruction of St. Paul. And may we, as the body of Christ, gathered together at LCI, join together and get into good trouble. Amen.
And now let us pray for the church and its people. Confident of your care and helped by the Holy Spirit, we pray for the church, the world, and all who are in need. God of faithfulness, you bid your people to follow Jesus. Set the mind of your church on divine things. Grant us trust in you that we lose our lives for the sake of Christ and thereby discover joy in life through him. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of wonder, the earth is yours and all that is in it. Heal your creation, especially those areas destroyed by fire, and give us eyes to see the world as you do, As the seasons change, pattern the rhythm of our lives in harmony with all creation. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of nations, you call us to live peaceably with all. Give us ears to hear one another, even those we name as enemies. Fill all leaders with mercy and understanding that they may advocate and genuinely care for all those who are poor and most vulnerable in their communities, especially all of those who have suffered from fire. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of salvation, you promised to deliver us. Give those who suffer a strong sense of your presence and love. Comfort and sustain those who have lost homes, family members, and animals. Protect the firefighters and all first responders. Accompany those who are uncertain. Raise the spirits of those who are despairing and heal the sick. Help us to prevent the spread of this current virus and treat those suffering from it. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of community, you call us to rejoice in hope, be patient in suffering, and persevere in prayer. Make our congregation a workshop of your love, even in this season of separation. When we quarrel, bring reconciliation. Help us overcome evil with good. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of all grace, you give us everlasting life. In love, we recall your holy ones who now live in your undying light. In our remembering, give us a foretaste of the feast to come. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In the certain hope that nothing can separate us from your love, we offer these prayers to you through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Gathered by the Spirit into one body, let us pray as our Lord Jesus taught. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. We'll now have a time of special music and offering.
Amen.
Let us pray. Gracious God, we offer with joy and thanksgiving what you have first given us, ourselves, our time, and our possessions, signs of your gracious love. Receive them for the sake of the one who offered himself for us, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Live your lives in Christ, rooted and built up in him, and abound in thanksgiving, and the blessing of the Holy be upon you and remain with you forever. Amen. Go in peace, sharing Christ's light daily. Thanks be to God, and we will.